All right, folks, the Word of God is alive and powerful. Yes, it is. And it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrow. And what is it? It is a critic of the thoughts and intents of the heart. What you think and why you do it. All Scripture, not just a little bit, all Scripture is God-breathed. And what's it doing? It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be mature, thoroughly furnished into all good works. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And what do we say? The spiritual spin stops right here. Why? Because I really care for you. So with your heads bowed and eyes closed, you make your own way with the Lord through the confession of your own personal sins. And if necessary, use Romans 6:6, 6:11, 6:13. I'll close at our prayer time, and wow, we're going to pick up another study of the Word of God. Heads bowed and eyes closed, you make your own way with the Lord. Father, we thank you this morning for the privilege of studying your word. Without your word, there is no word from you. And in this spiritual battle that we know as the angelic conflict, oh my goodness, what a tragedy how few people really understand the nature of your plan. So with that in mind, as we open the word of God this morning and attack this subject of apostasy, Father, if we just understand the concept of apostasy and take a look around and see what's going on in the world today, say, wow, I understand, Lord, I understand, but I don't want to be a part of that. And I'm not going to be a part of it because I want to know your word. I want to be a part of this plan. I want to be all that you want me to be. I not only want to know your word, Father, I want to demonstrate it in my life. Thinking like Christ thinks, feeling like he feels, speaking like he speaks, and doing like he did. How about this? Doing like he would do if he were here right now. Well, with that in mind, Father, let's turn to this book of Jude and continue with our study as Jude is trying to enlighten us to a problem that had occurred in the local assemblies in his day, and he was warning people of that. Well, I'll tell you what, if he was warning them back there, I don't know what we do here. It's not a matter of just saying, hey, we got some apostasy out here. We need to ring every bell. We need to beat every pan. We need to let go with every siren to say, wake up, America. Wake up, America. And I pray this in Christ's name and for his sake. Amen. Well, our subject today, again, is Jude 1. There's only one chapter in Jude, 25 verses. The same as in Philemon, very short books, but oh my, how powerful when you understand them. Part 3, let's turn to our study. Let's do just a brief review. Jude is the author of the epistle. 25 verses, that's it. Someone might say, oh, goodness gracious, why is it just such a short epistle? Well, we talked about that last Wednesday evening. Jude is the half-brother of the humanity of Christ. You remember the humanity of Christ? Totally God, totally human. God wrapped up in one person forever. Jude is warning the local assembly of apostasy. Jude is warning the people in the area that he's writing. We don't know who he's writing to, just Christians. We have no idea where he was when he wrote it. We have no idea to whom he was writing it, except for the fact we know he was writing to Christians. And he was warning those local assemblies, we call it the church, He was warning those local assemblies about the infiltration of false doctrine. Men coming into the assembly, oh, they dress so well, they're articulate, their hair is combed so sweet, and oh my goodness, look at the shoes. Oh, their vocabulary is absolutely fantastic. They're coming in looking nice with this nice personality and everything else, and they're going to attempt to steal these people away from the truth. But the truth of the matter is if you don't know the truth, it's so easily to be persuaded to move away. This is why until a pastor, teacher, whoever he is not teaching the Word of God eisegetically, categorically, and exegetically, and then expositing the Word of God so that those of you in the pew are able to grow from babyhood to adolescence to spiritual maturity, moving through the three stages of spiritual maturity, from spiritual self-esteem to spiritual autonomy to maximum spiritual maturity, you don't have a clue about what's going on in life today. Oh, yes, it's nice and it's bad. It's this, it's that. Yes, I understand that. But as far as the Word of God and the plan of God for your life is concerned, you don't have a clue. So in verse 4, he says to these people, apostate teachers have already infiltrated your local assemblies. And listen, I'm telling you right now that if I actually listed right now what's going on in the local assemblies, we called it the church, but is it the church in the wilderness? Is it the church of Jesus Christ? Or is it the assembly of born-again Christians? See, the three different uses of that word church. So when you use the word church, oh, there's a church in the Old Testament. No, there isn't. There is an ecclesia. There is an assembly of believers. So that we have church one, church two, church three. And we need to realize that when we talk about church three, the ecclesia number three, we're talking about the body of Christ. And what took place in the Gospels, what took place on the day of Pentecost was not the body of Christ. We don't have born-again Christians until Acts chapter 9, where Paul was the first born-again Christian. But in this, quote, church three, within the assemblies of people who are born-again Christians, we had already seen people infiltrating, trying to take them away. Oh, let's go back. Oh, no, if you're a born-again Christian, you must keep the law. No, you don't. You don't keep the law. No, this is a grace period of time. We live by grace, not by works. So Jude was explaining these infiltrators. And then in verse 5, he says, let me tell you where these people come from. So in verse 5, we find an example of apostate believers. These are people who are born again, who don't have a clue about what the Christian way of life is all about. So until you understand how to live an experientially spiritual Christian life, your trend toward asceticism, your lascivious self-righteousness makes you believe that everything's cool with you until you reach the Bema seat, only to find out that every good thing you do goes up in smoke. Wow. Apostate believers. Then Jude gives an example of apostate angels. How those angels left their first estate, living in the sphere of angelicism, if you can put it that way. No, these angels in Genesis 6 said, look at those women down there. Oh my, oh my, oh my. Remember angelic conflict? Satan had a plan. If these angels would just go down there and cohabit with the female of the human species and bear half angel, half man, guess what? We will destroy the human race, and God has a plan to use the human race to resolve the angelic conflict. No human beings. We've actually gone in and wiped out the human race, half angel, half man. And guess what? Satan wins the angelic conflict. So Jude tells us then in verse 5 about these apostate angels. So what we need to do is, after seeing that he talks about apostate believers, apostate angels in verse 6, Jude 6 is actually a lead into verse 7. So let's read verse 6. It says, and angels who did not keep their own domain, and that means they didn't stay within the realm of angelic creaturehood, but came over into the human race, bore children to those women, those half women, half man, half angel, they died in the flood. God wiped out the human race except for seven people. Why? It's because in the angelic conflict, man had become so corrupt, so degenerate, that God had to wipe out the human race and start a new civilization with Noah and his seven family members. So in verse 6, he says, and angels who did not keep their own domain, but abandoned their proper dwelling place, they cohabited with women, these fallen angels, he has kept in eternal restraints under darkness for the judgment of the great day. What does that mean? These fallen angels are actually in a place called Tartarus. It's a place in the belly of the earth. Oh, and it's amazing. If you don't understand the Greek and the Hebrew, you're going to have trouble when you interpret the word of God. He didn't place these angels in hell, which is what the scripture says. No, he placed them in Tartarus. And Tartarus is an individual location in the belly of the earth where these angels are kept from the time he put them there until the end of human history, when in fact they will be raised out of that Tartarus and cast into the eternal lake of fire. And that's why he says here, he said they didn't keep their own domain, but abandoned their proper dwelling place. And these fallen angels that cohabit with the daughters of men, he put them in Tartarus, and they are in eternal restraints. They don't get out of Tartarus. And once he takes them out of Tartarus, he puts them into the lake of fire. Both of these result in eternal restraints until the great day of judgment, which is the end of human history. So at the end of human history, he takes them out of Tartarus and casts them into the lake of fire. These are fallen angels, and Jude is using these as an example of degeneracy of the angelic realm, a portion of it. Someone asked the question the other night. We know that God created angels. We also know that one third of those angels followed after Satan when Satan says, I'm out of here. Look at my beauty, look at my wisdom. I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. Five I wills. And last I wills, I will become like the Most High. Wait a minute, just a second. If Satan is going to become like the Most High, most people think that Satan's interested in you sinning. Satan doesn't want you to sin. Satan wants you to do good independently from God. Isn't that amazing? Satan wants man to do good independent from God. That's why we have human good and divine good. Human good is just you and the energy of the flesh going out there and doing good. But until you're functioning in the sphere of the spirit, all of your good is not divine good. It is human good and will burn at the Bema Seat. And if it happens to be an unbeliever at the great white throne, your righteousness will not match what Jesus did on the cross for you, and you're headed for the lake of fire. So these angels didn't keep the first estate. They're in Tartarus. They're going to be in the lake of fire forever. And Jude uses them as an example. Now we move into verse 7 then, and he says, just as Sodom and Gomorrah. Now remember, in verse 5, we have apostate believers. These are people who are spreading false information. In verse 6, we have these apostate angels, degenerate, spreading false information. Now in verse 7, just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, since they, in the same way as these angels, indulged in sexual perversion and went after strange flesh. and exhibited an example in undergoing the punishment of eternal fire. They exhibited an example in undergoing the punishment of eternal fire. Well, let's talk about this. That's the Good News Translation. I just read from the New American Standard. Listen to a Good News Translation of that same verse. Remember, Sodom and Gomorrah and the nearby towns whose people acted as those angels did and indulged in sexual immorality and perversion, listen, they suffer the punishment of eternal fire as a plain warning. Listen, it's a plain warning to who? To everyone, you, me, and anyone else. Now, what we find in Jude 7, then, is the third type of apostasy. People spreading false information. And listen, by the way, what I'm about to say may turn you off. But this is your problem, not mine. I'm a pastor teacher. My responsibility is to teach the Word of God as God intended it to be understood. Now, with that in mind, when you take a look, and I have written something down here on a piece of paper before we get started to make sure if I see it, I'll remember to tell you. First of all, you need to look up the word woke. W-O-K-E. It's being used, bannered about, on the news, in the magazines, in the paper, on TV. People are using this word. Listen, until, you know, within the last couple of years, never heard that word used this way. Living in this generation, you may have a wonderful vocabulary and wake up tomorrow and find out you don't understand anything anybody's talking about because of the way they're interpreting words, changing the meaning of words, and that kind of thing. You need to look up the word woke. W-O-K-E. Now, when you do that and look it up, what I'd like for you to do is to ask yourself, are you woke? And if you're not, why not? And if you are woke and you understand the meaning of you're woke in terms of the meaning of that, you need to ask yourself, which side of the equation are you standing on as far as wokeness is concerned? Because if you understand it, you could be being viewed by the liberal left as someone that is the great problem in this country. This is why we need to be able to interpret contemporary history in the light of God's word. And this is why when you teach the word of God, you exegete the word of God. And when you do, you consider grammar, syntax, and etymology, the derivation of the meaning of words, and interpret the word of God within the framework of the historical context. It's not just, oh yeah, this is what this means. Oh no. No, not at all. So in Jude 7, we find the third type of apostasy. And this is the apostasy that is among unbelievers. So in verse 5, we have believer apostasy. In verse 6, we have angelic apostasy. And in verse 7, we have unbelievers functioning in apostasy. And really, unbeliever apostasy is the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. My mind is racing. As I was studying and preparing for today's lesson, you go out and you sort of search certain things. And when you're dealing with this idea of apostasy in Sodom and Gomorrah, it's amazing how many people are writing on, if you Google something, if you Bing it, however you want to search, you come up with all kinds of information as to why God didn't really see homosexuality and lesbianism as a big problem in Sodom and Gomorrah. See, apostasy, changing the meaning of the word of God. So with that in mind, unbeliever apostasy, Sodom and Gomorrah. So we have a believer apostasy in 5, angelic apostasy in 6, unbeliever apostasy in verse 7. And what this means is we have people who are teaching false information to distract those people who want to know the truth and lead them away. Why? Because of the angelic conflict. And the angelic conflict is not over until the end of human history. Now let's pull this verse apart. He says, just as. What does that mean? Just as what? He's talking about just as fallen angels became degenerate in verse 6, just as. This is why I indicated that when we began to look at verse 7, we need to take a look at verse 7 in the light of verse 6. Remember the context? So just as fallen angels became degenerate in verse 6, unbelievers, and by that, see, these are fallen angels who become degenerate. They're already out of the plan of God. But they became degenerate in the sense that of some of them actually copulated with a female of the human species. Now, that's not all of the fallen angels. One third of the angels went after Satan, but among that one third, some of those actually were the ones that copulated with the female of the human species. So just as fallen angels became degenerate in verse 6, unbelievers now become degenerate in verse 7. Sodom, it says, Sodom and Gomorrah, just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them. Let me see. We hear about Sodom and Gomorrah. But I wonder who these other cities are. Haven't heard much about them. Well, who are they? That phrase, and the cities around them. So we know about Sodom and Gomorrah. We've heard about that for, many, many years. Oh, this horrible cities over here, Sodom and Gomorrah, yes. But he also says, and the cities around them. So it's not just Sodom and Gomorrah. The cities around them, in addition to Sodom and Gomorrah, there were three other cities mentioned in Scripture. Well, what are they? Let's go back to Hosea chapter 11, verse 8. It says, How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I surrender you, Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? He says, my heart is turned away, turned over. My heart is turned over within me, and all my compassions are kindled. Now, in context, those three cities are related to Sodom and Gomorrah in that same general area. In Lamentations, it says, for the wrongdoing of the daughter, that was Judah, that was the southern kingdom. He says, for the wrongdoing of the daughter, that was Judah, of my people Israel, he says, is greater than the sin of Sodom. Listen to this now. He said, the wrongdoing of the daughter of my people is greater than the sin of Sodom. Homosexuality, lesbianism. And he says, which was overthrown as in a moment. And no hands were turned toward her. In Jeremiah 49:18. Like the overthrow of Sodom and Gomorrah with its neighbors, his neighbors, Ephraim, Admah, Zeboim, these five cities. Like the overthrow of Sodom and Gomorrah with its neighbors, says the Lord, listen, no one will live there, nor will any mankind reside in it. Got that? Why? Because of apostasy, because of evil. We'll find out more about that in just a moment. In verse 11, in Amos 4, he said, I overthrew you, past tense. I overthrew you, Israel, as God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. And you were like a log snatched from a fire. Yet you have not returned to me, declares the Lord. Listen to this. God allowed Israel to be overthrown in the same way that God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. However, in the overthrowing of Israel, he said, you were like a log snatched from the fire. So you throw this log in the fire, it started to burn up. You say, I don't want that to burn. You reach down, you grab it, and you pull it out of the fire. So what happens in the overthrowing of Israel, as God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah, Israel was like a log snatched from a fire. There they were. They were under divine discipline, and God reaches down and takes them back out of there, and he says, now that I've taken you out, what are you going to do? Are you going to get it right? And he says, you have not returned to me, declares the Lord. So what we have is the five cities, Sodom and Gomorrah, Ephraim, Admah, and Zeboim. They're doing the same thing. These are unbelievers who are degenerate, and we'll find out what they're doing here shortly. In these five cities, let's talk about these five cities for just a moment. As we're reading through Scripture, and when you're back in the Old Testament and you're studying Israel, and remember, Israel had a different set of laws, a different set of guidelines to live their life as born-again Christians than we do as the body of Christ. So going before the age of grace began, we have these Israelites, these Jews, living according to the law. But as you read through the Old Testament, you realize how often and how many times Israel, the people of Israel, the Jews, didn't get it. Oh, they were going to the temple. They go to the synagogue. They hear about this Jesus time and time and time again, but they don't see who he really is. They never accept him. They don't accept him as their Lord and Savior. So what happens? God looks down and sees this. You're getting all this information about a man who's going to, a God man who's going to come. He's going to be crucified, dead, buried. He'll be resurrected. He's going to ascend, be seated at my right hand. And he says, look, you folks, you're going astray. Every time I turn around, you're going in the wrong direction. I discipline you. You get a chance to come back to me. He says, and what do you do? He said, as soon as I let go of the discipline, bingo, you're off in the other direction again. Apostate. So when we're looking at Scripture, there were three prophets, Hosea, Jeremiah, and Amos. As you read through those three books, Hosea, Jeremiah, and Amos, they talked about apostasy, just like Jude is talking about apostasy. Apostasy had infiltrated the local assemblies in Jude's day. He was upset about this. He wanted Christians to know the truth. Remember angelic conflict? So these three prophets, Hosea, Jeremiah, and Amos, they talked about apostasy, and when they wanted to make an illustration of apostasy, you know what they did? They mentioned a city that was known to their generation. And these cities, what are they? Sodom, Gomorrah, Ephraim, Admah, and Zeboim were very famous in the year 2065 BC. These were famous cities, but they weren't famous because they were righteous cities. This was where degeneracy was blown out of sight. They knew these cities. They knew what they were doing. They were degenerate. And these people, when these writers, Hosea, Jeremiah, and Amos, they want to make, hey, listen, I want you to understand something, Israel. You Jewish people, I want you to understand something. This is what's happening to you. And they use these five cities as an example. Now, let me point out something. This'll blow you away if you understand what's going on here. So you got Sodom, Gomorrah, Ephraim, Admah, and Zeboim. Okay, that's fine. What more do you know about? Well, no, they were apostate. They had a lot of homosexuality, lesbianism, and other things going on. They weren't righteous people. They were bad people. Well, when you understand geographically where these cities were, the geographic location of these cities is now established as the southern end of the Dead Sea. Are you ready? I'm asking, are you listening? The geographical location of these five cities is now established as the southern end of the Dead Sea, and the location is now underwater. You got that? I don't know what that means to you. But these cities were apostate. They had influence of the people all around them. We find Israel coming to God, turning their back and going another way, becoming apostate themselves. And the truth of the matter is that when you realize what God did to Sodom, Gomorrah, Ephraim, Admah, Zeboim, cities up here on the plain where you could walk through it, you could see it, the buildings and everything. It is now underwater. That's what God thinks of Sodom and Gomorrah and Ephraim and Admah and Zeboim. And when you think about this, listen, when you think about this, if you're truly wanting to live the Christian way of life, you're really truly wanting to interpret contemporary history, you're wanting to stand on the right side of history, you had better understand thoroughly what's going on in the United States of America today, because when you take a look at Sodom and Gomorrah and Ephraim and Admah and Zeboim and realize what God did to them and the influence they had on the people around them, and ask yourself, what is God going to do to this nation because of the apostasy that is rampant in this country? Not just in a political sense of the way, but when you take a look at what is happening in local assemblies across this country and the lack of sound Bible teaching. Now let me ask you to guard yourself about this. You may want to say, boy, is this guy arrogant? Well, listen, I'll take my stand with God. I'm a mouthpiece for God. He gave me this spiritual gift. And today we need to be shouting from the rooftop what's going on in order to preserve this country so that we can evangelize the lost, teach the saved, be able to send out missionaries, and be a friend of Israel. That's God's plan. And when you look around today and see people with money, good grief, people with money, where are they going? They realize how bad it is. And you know what? They think they have the answer. Let's just buy an island. So we're buying islands. Maybe we can just escape that way. Excuse me. The answer to apostasy is doctrine resident in your soul, so that you'll know how to stand in this period of time. And when you look at your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, and realize how many people are saying, good grief, do we understand really what's going on out here? Say, I'm going to be gone sometime soon. I don't know how soon is, but one of these days, God's going to say, your ministry is done, Jim. Your ministry is done, Bill. Whoever you happen to be, you're done. Come on up here. But we're not done down here yet. So the question is, when you see the mess that we're heading for in the tribulation, and God, thank God you won't be there, but you may leave your children here, you may leave your grandchildren here, you may leave your great-grandchildren here. So we need to be given the truth. And Sodom and Gomorrah and Ephraim and Admah and Zeboim are underwater in the Dead Sea. So he says, since they in the same way as the angels. Oh, wait a minute. So we got to go back to verse 6 again and find out what happened there. Well, these degenerate angels got involved in promiscuity, left their first estate and cohabited with the daughters of men. Sexual promiscuity outside the plan of God, outside the will of God. So he says, Sodom and Gomorrah, these five cities, since they in the same way as these angels, in verse 6, consider this. When the human race becomes degenerate, as certain fallen angels became degenerate, then the human race is no longer interested in normal sexual relationship. What happens? Sexual relationship progresses in an abnormal sexual relationship. An abnormal sexual relationship is coming up in verse 8. So we see, as a result of all the promiscuity, the homosexuality, the lesbianism, God destroying five cities where this was abundant, put them underwater. Nobody living in them anymore. This is what God thought of that. So within the population of those five cities, as far as we know, there were only three people who were believers. Lot and his two unmarried daughters. And the population of these five cities had been famous for homosexuality and lesbianism, and that fact is clearly taught in Scripture, and Scripture substantiates that. Substantiates what? That homosexuality and lesbianism in these five cities, this is what was taking place. In Genesis 19, verse 4 and 5, it says, before the guests went to bed, now this is in Sodom, Lot's there, he has some guests come into his house. How would you like this? Just in the last, listen, in the last 2 days, we've had guests come into our home from outside the area. So living in Sodom and Gomorrah, or these other three cities, there are a group of men in the city, and they say, "Ooh, just a second, Jim has some friends that just visited him, and ooh, yeah, there's some men in that house." This is what was happening back in Sodom. It said, before the guests went to bed, these the guests of Lot came to visit. Said the men of Sodom, ooh, there are the men of Sodom, oh, we're out running, having a late night party, we're out running, doing whatever they're doing, and oh, hey, guess what? Lot's got some friends at his house, and all the men of the city, both young and old, were there, and they called out to Lot and asked, where are those men who came to stay with you tonight? Hey, Lot. We understand we saw the men walk in the house there. We don't know who they are, but they're with you. Why don't you send them out to us? Said, where are the men who came to stay with you tonight? Bring them out to us! Exclamation point! Bring them out! The men of Sodom wanted to have sex with these men. What? Yeah, that's the way it was. Yeah, that's the way it was. And when you look around and see all that's going on, the perversion in our country. What? It's amazing. You have to be blind not to understand what's going on. But, conjunction of contrast, what Jude mentions next is even more extensive result of apostasy. Oh yeah, we're going to see that in a minute. Oh, excuse me, sir. I understand you got some friends in there, male and female. Hey, send the men out here. We want to have sex with them. When Jude mentions what Jude is going to mention next is even more extensive result of apostasy. And yet the area, that whole area, Sodom, Gomorrah, Ephraim, etc., that area was destroyed in the middle of the 21st century BC. Why was it destroyed? It was destroyed because of the apostasy. These unbelievers had gone away from anything that God would have for them. First of all, they had to become believers. They said, no, I don't want that. I would rather just continue with my sexual relationship with men. That's much better than any plan God would have for me. That's only one problem. So the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah is not only taught clearly in Genesis 19, but its destruction is referred to specifically under doctrinal concepts of Matthew 10, 15, and 2 Peter 2, 6. Let's go back to Genesis 19. By the time Lot reached Zoar, Lot's traveling, he gets to a city called Zoar. He said, the sun had risen over the land. Then the Lord rained down, Then the Lord rained down burning sulfur on Sodom and Gomorrah. Get out of here, Lot. You need to get out of here. So Lot bails out. He gets out, starts to travel. He gets to Zoar. God says, okay, Lot's out of town. He's far enough out now. Let's do it. And he burns down sulfur on Sodom and Gomorrah. And where did it come from? It came from the Lord out of the heavens. Thus he overthrew those cities. What cities? Those five cities we just mentioned. And the entire plain, that entire surrounding area, destroying, oh my goodness, destroying all those who lived in the cities. You get that? And the vegetation, in the land. God destroyed them. Why? Because they were apostate. They were unbelievers. He knew that there was no hope for them. They would not come to Jesus Christ. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to show these people what apostasy is like. I'm going to show them how I deal with apostasy. And guess what? He destroyed the entire area and put it underwater. Matthew 10:15 says, truly I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that city. God's pronouncing judgment. 2 Peter 2:6. And if he condemned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, that's a first-class condition, and he did. If God condemned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, let me move this, to destruction. He condemned the cities to destruction. How? By reducing them to ashes, having made them an example of what is coming for the ungodly. Hold it now. Wait a minute, about God. I thought God was a compassionate God. I thought he loved everybody. Yes, he does. Agape love. Agape love. What that means is God has a relaxed mental attitude toward every human being on the planet. He has given you the freedom, the right to make any decision you want to. But unless you line up with the plan of God, you will not be blessed. You will be cursed. And just like Sodom and Gomorrah, you see that what we see here for Sodom and Gomorrah and these other three cities is divine discipline. God says, look, if you don't get it, I'll bring pressure to your life. When the pressure comes, you know your plan isn't working. Oh, now I know that you can suffer. Yes, you can suffer by association. You can suffer by association. Those of us who live in the United States today are suffering by association with an ungodly administration in Washington, D.C. So he goes on in his verse and says, in the same way as angels, what did they do? In the same way as angels, these people in Sodom and Gomorrah indulged in sexual perversion, fornication. He said, and they went after. That phrase, and went after, means they pursued sexual activity. They pursued it vigorously, and they went after it. They went after it. And what were they going after? Listen to this. They went after strange flesh. And you know what strange flesh is? That's bestiality. You remember the angels left their first estate and cohabited with the daughters of men? These are men who are actually having sex with animals. Over the course of my lifetime, I am aware of men who've been involved in this. When I was working with the FBI, it's been a long time since I told this brief story. When I was working with the FBI, I was searching criminal fingerprints. I was working in the criminal division of the FBI as far as fingerprints were concerned. So when you go to work, they'd have this stack of fingerprints where someone had been arrested anywhere in the United States. They would take those fingerprints and they would send them to the FBI in Washington, D.C., and you would search wings and cabinets, eye high, drawers filled with criminal fingerprints, and you would search those fingerprints, these files, to find if they had been arrested prior to that time. And if you did, you matched it and sent it to headquarters, and they took it from there. But I picked up this card one day, and I was reading on the back of it as I was getting ready to categorize the fingerprints, and it said on the back, this person was arrested for having sex with a goat in the open field. Having sex with a goat in an open field. When I was in the Navy, we heard of a port somewhere in Mexico where people could have sex with animals. This is not something old. This is something that's going on right now. I knew a man who had a big dog that was having sex with his dog. Are you listening to me? It's the angelic conflict. God has a plan for our lives. And what was going on in these cities that are now underwater at the bottom of the Dead Sea was sexual perversion. Jude is emphasizing in this verse, strange flesh, he is emphasizing bestiality over homosexuality. Now the question, we know that from scripture that Sodom and Gomorrah and these other three cities were involved in homosexuality and lesbianism. Well, why, if that's the fact, then why did Jude then not just say, hey, these folks were involved in homosexuality? He emphasizes bestiality. So we might raise a question, why did he do this? Why does Jude emphasize bestiality over homosexuality? And the answer is simple. Because of the direct analogy to fallen angels in Genesis 6, which he mentioned in the previous verse. See, the angels were having sexual relationship outside their sphere. Homosexuality is with human beings inside your sphere. But this is homosexual, this is sexual perversion with something outside your sphere, just like the angels in verse 6. You see, both groups, the angels and these unbelievers in Sodom, they were involved in this analogy. The fallen angels in verse 6 and the unbelievers in verse 7, guess what they're going to do? They will reside in the same place in eternity future, and that is the application of the rest of this verse. They're going to reside in the lake of fire forever. So they went after strange flesh and are exhibited as an example. As an example to who? These people and what God did with Sodom and Gomorrah and these other cities is an example to you and me. Example to us in the spiritual battle called the angelic conflict. God wants us to understand there is a plan for our lives. The plan is for us to follow God's plan for our life, that we might be a part of the resolution of the battle that began between he and Satan in eternity past. They're an example. At certain times, an example, listen to me, at certain times, an example is selected from among the human race. God says, wait a minute, ooh, my, look what's going on down there. Oh, boy, he said, what am I going to do? He said, tell you what I'm going to do. You see that big group down there? They're a mess. He said, I'm going to take a little group of that, and I'm going to use them. I'm going to examine them and make them an example. So in human history, throughout history, there are certain times when an example is selected from among the human race for an examination to serve as a warning to the rest of the human race. And this example is recorded for us in the Word of God as a warning. When you look today, for example, the gay pride marches, promoting the gay lifestyle, promoting perversion. Oh, but it's so good. They're a part of society. And put up a gay flag on the White House. What? Perversion. Apostasy. Wanting you to think, oh, this is okay. It's not okay. Let me tell you what, though. While I may be passionate about this, I can love those folks. I've had gay people, men, women, black, white, otherwise, sitting in my congregation. I love them with agape love, just like I love everybody else. But they were there. As far as I was concerned, they were there to get the truth about their lifestyle. And just because I saw a gay person walk through the door didn't make me change my message. My message was what I was given to deliver that day. But I can agape love gay people. I can agape love murderers, rapists. Agape love, folks. But justice will be meted out. It will be meted out. So God at times selects certain groups of people to serve as a warning to the rest of us. So the fallen angels of Tartarus and the unbelievers of Sodom are examples used to warn us against apostasy. What is apostasy? It's distortions of truth. What do we call that? We call that evil. Evil is any distortion of truth, no matter how slight the distortion. But people will come up to you and they'll tell you, for example, they want you to believe that, for example, speaking in tongues is valid today. No, it's not. No, it's not. Check out the scripture. Just because it says they spoke in tongues doesn't make it valid today. Others are going to want you to tithe. Tithing is not for the body of Christ. It's grace giving. You determine how much to give. I don't determine what you give. You give what the Spirit of God is leading you to give. You don't have to be baptized to be saved. And yet people are telling you, see, this is apostasy. It's heresy. It's heresy. You can love people who believe this with agape love, but you have to take a stand for the truth. This is not some ball game. This is not some foolish thing that's going on. Now, by the way, football is not foolish. But this is not some, it's not a baseball game. This is not some game. This is not some other game we're playing. This is life. And you're a part of it. You were injected in the angelic conflict the moment you were born physically. And the moment you were born again, God put you on the front line. But you put you on the front line, you're out there with no ammunition, and you're getting shot to death, shot to death, shot to death. Wounded by the fiery darts of the devil. Why? Because doctrine is the issue in your life after you're saved. Just not reading the scripture, not just memorizing scripture. It's knowing the terminology. It's categorization of truth. So the fallen angels of Tartarus and the unbelievers in Sodom are examples and used to warn us of apostasy and warn us about the importance of the five. Listen, to warn us of the five divine institutions. And people said, what in the world are you talking about? Five divine institutions. Yes, God has given every human being, male, female, black, white, rich, poor, educated, uneducated. He's given us five divine institutions to live by in the period of human history, from beginning to end, and those five divine institutions are freedom. Uh-oh, hold it now. Freedom is a divine institution. God gave us freedom. Freedom belongs to you. Now, what about the apostasy in this day? Somebody telling you, oh, no, 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 we need to have this part of your freedom. We need to have that. No, you can't say this. No, you can't do this. You can't worship. You have to have a mask on. Wait a minute, just a minute. No, you don't get fair treatment. We'll just bust your door down and come get your computer and whatever. What? Hold it just a moment. The fallen angels of Tartarus and unbelievers of Sodom are examples used to warn us against apostasy and to warn us about the importance of the five divine institutions. Freedom, marriage. Wait a minute, marriage? What's happening in this country and around the world today as far as marriage is concerned? No, we'll just sleep together. No, we'll just live together. That's okay. No, nobody will make it. I'm going to stretch this a little bit. People don't care about marriage today. That's the majority of people, okay? I grew up in a day and age when nobody got married. Just come on, we all live together. That means sleep together, have sex together. Right? Jude is warning us about this. Freedom, marriage, family. Have you seen anything any worse than the families in this country today? Split 90 different directions. Freedom going down the tube. Marriage, maybe so, maybe not, you know. Who cares? Yeah. Maybe the next time around will be okay. Freedom, marriage, family. Messed up. Who's my daddy? Who's my dad? I don't know. My daddy's out there somewhere. Nationalism. Because you're patriotic, because you believe in the Constitution, you believe in the Bible. Somehow or another, that makes you whatever. No. When you hold to these five divine institutions, this is God's plan for our life. Nationalism, patriotism, flying the flag. We know what that stands for. It's not to be thrown on the ground and burnt. It's not to be spat on. It's not to be knelt. You don't kneel down when the... And what I'd like to see sometime is somebody sing the stars, sing the national anthem, and without all that garbage and up and down. It's more for them. How about just singing it for what it is? Stop and consider this. But by the way, let's finish the five divine institutions: freedom, marriage, family, nationalism, subtitled free market capitalism. Pre-market capitalism. And don't you be persuaded by the apostate kind of thinking that is down on free market capitalism because of crony capitalism. Crony capitalism is not capitalism. What is crony capitalism? Look it up. Look it up and see what it is. Crony capitalism. See, you're being led to believe by many out here that crony capitalism is capitalism, and we need to get rid of capitalism, and we need something like socialism, Marxism, fascism, communism. Excuse me. God gave us a country, and God gave us five divine institutions. And economically, it's free market capitalism, period. And the last is employment. And look at that today. Businesses being shut down. Go into a restaurant today and find people, since the masks are gone, people just exploding going into businesses now. And guess what? You got two people waiting on tables. You got 50 people in there. You got a ball team of young kids come in. It's wild. Five divine institutions given to us. And the warning with Sodom and Gomorrah, warnings just like that. How about, listen, this building that collapsed in Miami, God didn't cause it. But when you look at these things going on all over the country, God is drawing our attention to these things. Please, these are happening. God allows them to happen. Why? Just like Sodom and Gomorrah, it is to get our attention that something's wrong in either our life or the lives of the people that's going on around us. Stop and consider this. Apostasy and violating any of the five divine institutions. Listen, please. Violating any of the five divine institutions. Violation of freedom. Take my freedom of speech away. Take my right to assemble away. The right to go to the government and say, listen, there was a 9-year-old girl. Oh my goodness. I'm going to find it if I can. I'm going to find that again. A 9-year-old girl was brilliant sitting in front of a, I believe it was a school board. It was either a school board or a city council. But she was sitting there and she was reading this document with great articulation, and she was explaining to them why the critical race theory being imposed on schools was absolutely absurd, and she was calling them out to their face. It was amazing. It was brilliant. So consider this: apostasy and violating any of the five divine institutions, freedom, marriage, family, patriotism, free market capitalism, and employment, violation of any of those five divine institutions not only has temporal repercussions, that means repercussions in time before we get to the end of human history. These forms of apostasy, when you violate any of the five divine institutions, this is going to have repercussions in your life, in my life, in our lives. But in the closing out of this verse, in verse 7, apostasy is ignoring any of the five. Let me back up just a second. In closing out this verse, apostasy and ignoring any of the five divine institutions has eternal repercussions. So when we violate the five divine institutions, you have repercussions in time and you have repercussions in eternity. Isn't that amazing? Repercussions in eternity. Well, what might that mean? It simply means that when you fail here, you lose blessing and reward in eternity. And the rewards are given to us not to establish prominence for us. The rewards that we receive are honoring God, because it's His grace provision and His plan that we use to get them. So it goes on and says, are exhibited as an example in undergoing the punishment. Punishment is a function of divine justice. Listen to me, please. Punishment is a function of divine justice. God's righteousness looked down and says, let me examine what's going on down here. He looks down, he sees your life, and he sees you functioning in the sphere of the Spirit. This is not Pentecostal Holy Ghost flop on the floor stuff. That's not what it is. You learn to function in the sphere of the Spirit. That's the sphere of power that God wants us to have. You're functioning in there. You're living out your Christian life. And God says, I see that. My righteousness looks down and sees your righteousness. God's justice then says, I'm going to bless that person. God's righteousness looks down and sees negative volition, sees you avoiding the plan of God, functioning outside the plan of God, and justice then curses. You see, the righteousness of God is examining everything 24/7, 365. The righteousness of God is examining everything that's going on, every decision. And when he sees positive decisions, he blesses you. Justice will bless you. When he sees negative decisions, justice will curse you. So these examples here, Sodom and Gomorrah, the destruction of the cities, these are exhibited as an example of punishment. And what is the undergoing of punishment? These are unbelievers. The punishment is eternal condemnation. So in undergoing the punishment of eternal fire, that means refers to the eternal lake of fire. Unbelievers are cast in the lake of fire forever. There's no way out of the lake of fire once you get there. Now moving on. Every fallen angel and every unbeliever is in the eternal fire. They're in the lake of fire, which will be their final status. See, the final status of these angels, the final status of unbelievers, is in fact the lake of fire. And they will be there. Why? Because of negative volition on their part and the function of the justice of God. Righteousness looked down and saw, whoop, that's not good. That's not good. That's not right. You're not following my plan. You never believed in Jesus. Therefore, Your final condemnation is the lake of fire, and it is forever. Fallen angels are going to be in the lake of fire forever. Every unbeliever will be in the lake of fire forever. But understand this. Listen to me. We're talking about bestiality, okay? Understand this. No matter how bestiality affects a society, could you imagine if we lived in a society where men were just willy-nilly, just like the temples in Corinth, a temple on every corner. So, okay, you put a temple on every corner down here, got animals in there. I'm on my way home from work. I think I'll just stop in and have sex before I go. Now, as wild as that may seem to you, as abhorrent as that may seem to you, this is reality. This is life. Wake up. We have a responsibility to societies like this and all kinds of apostasy, not just bestiality. But no matter how bestiality affects a society, no matter how bestiality affects a segment of the population, bestiality is not the basis for going to hell or the lake of fire. For what these unbelievers did in time, they're actually going to suffer in time, but they will also suffer in eternity, the eternal lake of fire, because the word that's used in this passage, the Greek word is dike, D-I-K-E, and that means the justice of God. These people will be in the lake of fire forever because they failed to do what God wanted, and the justice of God said, here's your punishment, here's your out. Eternal lake of fire forever. See, the justice of God is the factor in the life of unbelievers. The justice of God is the righteousness of God is looking for absolute righteousness, doesn't find it. Said, okay, justice of God says, righteousness did not see righteousness in you, therefore you're headed to the lake of fire. Those who are in the lake of fire forever are those who rejected Jesus Christ and what he accomplished for them on the cross. Now, when we get to verse 8, see, we've seen three different categories of apostasy. Now, when we get to verse 8 through 13, we're going to get a broad picture. It's sort of a panorama. It's like looking at the horizon. We're going to see the big picture. And what we're going to see in this passage in verses 8 through 13 are three characteristics of apostasy. Let's look at verse 8. We've got about 7 minutes left. Verse 8 says, yet in the same way, these people also, dreaming, what do? They defile the flesh, they reject authority, and they speak abusively of angelic majesties. Stop right there. Listen to that again. We've already seen in 5, 6, and 7, three different categories of apostasy. Then in verse 8, he says, yet in the same way. We'll take a look and see what that means. In the same way, what? These people also. Now we're looking at a group of people, and what are they doing? They're apostate. They're heretical. And here's what they're doing. Three things. They're dreaming. And their dreaming defiles the flesh. That's one. They're dreaming. And the result of that dreaming is defiling the flesh. Secondly, they reject authority. And thirdly, they speak abusively of angelic majesties. What in the world does that mean? Let's look at it. The first phrase is yet in the same way. Now, what we've done here is we've studied three categories of apostasy. In 5, 6, and 7, we saw the unbeliever in 5. We saw the fallen angel in 6. And we saw the unbeliever. Stop right here. These three similar things are, they're right, but I was getting ready to give you the wrong verse. In the same way, in a similar manner as the unbeliever, that was verse 7. In the similar manner of the fallen angel, that's 6. In the similar manner of verse 5 is the believer in apostasy. So when he says in the same way, he's actually talking about what happened in 5, 6, and 7. These people also, who are these people? These people are the apostate believers who are infiltrating local assemblies. I'm writing to you folks over here. Just look around. He said, you've got these apostate people that are coming in and teaching false doctrine to you as believers. So he says, yet in the same way, these people also, and these are apostate believers who are infiltrating the local assemblies. What are they doing? He said, here's what they're doing. He says, dreaming. And that Greek word dreaming then is E-N-U-P-N-I-A-Z-O-M-A-I. In up. Niadzomai. In up niadzomai. That's the word. In up niadzomai. What does that mean? That's translated dreaming. But this is not like going to bed and having a dream. That's not what we're talking about. How about if I said this? You said, Jim, here's what I'd like to have. I would like to have $1 million. I'd like to have a nice big car. I'd like to buy an island for vacation spot. And I say to you, okay, that sounds good, but where are you working? And you say, well, I'm working so-and-so. And I say, well, what are you making an hour? He said, well, I make just a little over minimum wage. And I said, you want a big home? You want a big car? You want $1 million? And you're working for just a little over minimum wage? I said, man, you're dreaming. You're dreaming. See, that's the kind of dreaming we're talking about here. These apostate people are coming into the church and they're dreamers. They're dreamers. This is hoping or desiring for something that's contrary to God's plan, and then expecting God to give you what you hope for or what you desire to receive or achieve. Oh, yes, I want all this, Lord. Yes, I do. You're dreaming, man. You can't have it. You're dreaming, sir. You're dreaming, lady. You can't have it. So that's what a dreamer is, okay? It's delusionary dreaming, and indicates that the dreamers completely are out of touch with reality. They're out of touch with the principles of God's kingdom. They don't understand his plan. But here they are. Oh, there they are, these great dreamers. Oh my goodness. How many times have you been told, follow your dream? Follow your dream. No, follow the word of God. Follow the word of God. This is what these people are doing. Delusionary dreaming. So until people get back to the word of God, see, if you don't understand the word of God, if you don't understand the plan of God, guess what you're going to do? You're going to have this dream of life. Oh, I want to achieve this. And even if you achieve it, you're going to be empty because it's not God's plan for your life. Delusionary dreamers are dreaming false doctrine. They're thinking false doctrine. They're simply thinking human viewpoint. This is the way I see it. Well, what about God? I don't care about him. This is the way I see it. Human viewpoint, not divine viewpoint. He said, yet in the same way, these people dreaming, what do? They defile the flesh. And that word defile means stain, pollute, defile, corrupt. They defile the flesh. This is the first effect of delusionary dreaming. So if you're this delusionary dreaming, what are you going to do? First of all, what you're going to do is you're going to mess up your head, no doctrine. And when you mess up your head, guess what that does? That affects your body. And the next thing you know, you're indulging in corruption, passions, and whatever your appetite wants. That's not food. It's whatever you want in life. You defile the flesh. That's what he says of them. Then he said they reject authority. This is the second effect of delusionary dreaming. Apostasy is defined in this verse. How is apostasy defined? It's defined as rejection of authority. In this verse, rejection of authority. Without regard to whether the authority is human authority or divine authority. It doesn't make any difference whether you're defying the authority of the police officer, your husband, or the teacher, the principal of the school. Divine authority. It means it's Do you see what's happening in our country regarding authority? The authority of the police officer? The authority of the school teacher? We're out of time. You defile the flesh, you reject authority, and one other thing. What do? You speak abusively. The third effect of delusionary dreaming is constantly blaspheming, constantly maligning. But who are they maligning? The word of angelic majesty, that's the word doxa. It means glorious ones. It's plural. It means glorious ones. So what is the person who is apostate doing? They are maligning. They're blaspheming the Trinity. So here's the truism. The answer to each of these forms of apostasy, defiling the flesh, rejecting authority, speaking abusively, what is the answer for that? It's found in the application of pertinent doctrine, applying the Word of God to life. But if you don't know the Word of God, you can't do it. Father, thank you so much for Jude. Is giving us examples of apostasy. I hope we understand better, making an application all around us to what's going on. For those who see, Father, it is so evident what's happening in our country, around the world. Many people are praying for your son to come back, get this mess over, as far as we're concerned. But listen, no, this is opportunity to witness. It's an opportunity to show people what the Christian way of life is really all about. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. We'll praise you for all that you are, who you are, what you are, and praise you for your grace provision for us. I pray, Father, we'll just take advantage of the grace provision you've made for us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Folks, God bless all of you. Thank you so much for being logged on with me today. We'll be back on this coming Wednesday, but I'm going to go ahead and shut this down, and we'll be back Wednesday. God bless all of you, and good day. Listen, don't go away. Don't go away just yet. Please don't go away. I just got a message. Joey Simmons is online with us here, and he just told me that he is in the hospital. He has COVID, so he's requested our prayers. Joey Simmons, very, very fine young man. So put him on your prayer list and raise him up to God. He's in the hospital with COVID. Thank you very much, folks.